Billingsgate Market Governor Roger Barton has worked in London's fish market for over 50 years.
They never worried about the weather when they come back from Dunkirk, did they?
His ruthless approach to business has earned him a fortune, a couple of criminal convictions, and the nickname the Bastard of Billingsgate.
Ah, you want to play hardball with me? No problem.
And he's a competitive bastard too.
They're out to sell their fish, I'm out to sell my fish. And may the best man win.
A workaholic, his life in the market has come at a cost.
In 50 years, all I've taken is 5 weeks holiday. A lot of people say I'm a lunatic. Maybe they're right.
Now, Roger's finally leaving Billingsgate to follow a dream of exploring the world's greatest food markets. These markets are the beating heart of the greatest cities on Earth. They feed vast populations and are home to the poorest slumdog and the fattest fat cat. Roger isn't going empty-handed. The programme makers have given him a fighting fund to trade with.
Working in markets, and the only way to learn is to put your money in.
Pitting himself against the world's sharpest traders, can the Bastard of Billingsgate make a few quid in another man's market?
And let me see. Let's see how good this Englishman is. He might think he's good. Now let's see how good he really is. Taxi! Fish market, please, taxi driver.
The city that never sleeps is one of the richest on our planet.
Look at this. This is amazing. This is Mises. It's lit up every... There's nowhere that's not lit up. You know, it's like the middle of the day.
But cross the Harlem River from Manhattan and you enter the Bronx. A different world, where the streetlights fade and cops don't want to go. This is the district of Hunts Point, home to the biggest and roughest fish market in America.
Yeah, it's very dangerous. I hear the story that somebody got shot over there and get bullets in the head.
Yeah.
And they put it in the freezer over there.
Oh, well, we'll see what we'll see, won't we?
From midnight till dawn, for the next 3 weeks, Roger's new manor is the new Fulton Fish Market.
I know I'd go from rags to riches if you would only say yes.
Bring out the group of 3 to 5 and 2 to 3.
Those are 4 and a half.
You want 2 of those?
Bella Muddy? No.
This is the biggest stand I've ever seen of fish. My stand would fit into this, and I would think, 1,000 times. And I've got a big stand. These boys are not playing about. They go into fish in a big way.
Over $1 billion passes through Fulton Market each year, and every business is competing for one thing, the customer's hard-earned cash.
Certainly no hiding here.
How much? Go home, get out of here.
You'll be seen on show with what you've got. If you're messing it up, everybody will know about what's going on. You can't hide here, brother. I just want to look round. Size up the opposition. They all look good. There's not many young men, they all look old chaps, so it'll be a formidable task. Never mind, off we go.
These old chaps are some of the toughest traders in America.
First time you're in New York?
First time I've ever been here.
Welcome aboard, mate.
Thank you.
You've got Eddie Manali, the veteran Italian, working the market for 43 years. Big Joe Halibut, shifts more halibut in a night than London does in a week.
I'm the halibut king in New York.
Salvatore arrived 8 years ago from Wall Street.
Because he's Italian.
They seem all right on the surface, but most people do. It's when you scratch the surface, you'll find out what they're really like. I will do my best here because I think we got a chance.
No, no, no.
At the top of the tree, there's Frank.
You know it's not 275, you lying. Take the ticket and tell him he can wipe his ass with it.
Frank's the president of the traders.
Can I help you?
You must be Frank. I'm Roger.
Nice hat.
Pleased to meet you.
I was going
to
give you a dollar. I thought you were looking for money. I'm sorry. Nice meeting you.
He's agreed to take Roger on as an apprentice salesman.
Code number, okay?
Right.
He needs 5x50 of hake, okay?
Right.
This is the cheap shit scale, okay? And you gotta make sure it's always registered to zero. Roger, they're not babies. Just dump it. Just dump them. You don't have to be that kind to them, all right? They're dead. They have no heads.
Okay.
Roger, watch.
There
you go. That's all you gotta do. You gotta put the fish in it first. But he's got to do the job. If he's not going to do the job, if he's going to screw around, he doesn't know what he's doing, he's going to be in the way, okay? You got to move fast, he's got to know what he's doing, and he's got to know and stay on the stand. No offense, if he doesn't do the job right, I'm going to tell him to f*** off, okay? That's it. No ifs, ands, or buts.
I've got to be alert, I've got to be on the ball, I've got to know what I'm selling. I mustn't let them hang around, otherwise, they'll be gone. So I'm on the ball, and I feel good, I'm up for it. I want to serve them. Frank, I'll stop anybody that goes by. I'm better than Gordon Banks.
Whatever you got to do, Roger, drop your pants, do a dance. I can give a shit less to sell the fish, that's all. At the end of the day, I don't want to see a goddamn fish on the stand, that's all.
I got a nice sea bass.
Perch, 135.
With nearly 100,000 tons of fish sold each year, the traders at Fulton feed New York, serving every Jewish hotel, Chinese restaurant, and Greek diner from Connecticut to Coney Island.
Porgies, you buy? You want porgy? Honey, you don't use any porgy, frozen porgies? Rosie, frozen porgies, you're good? How many you want?
Their product has a shelf life of only 3 days.
Come right here, brother. Of course it's fresh, like me, fresh.
The pressure's on to get it sold.
I got a jumbo over here.
Well, you see, guys, you got to grab them. You got to call them from far away, you know, before they get to somebody else who's got the same stuff you got.
Competitive, super competitive. This is competition right here.
Yellowtails, special deal, special. You got to be a son of a bitch to make money. Porgies, you got to outthink your competition. You got to outbid your competition. You got to hope when there's a lot of fish around and you make the first move, you're the first guy to drop. You got to hope everybody else drops with you. Because if they don't drop with you, you sold too cheap. And you're not going to make any money that day.
Pointer.
Roger might know fish, but without knowing the customers, he's not going to make a dime.
Good price, 175 or 150. Tell me, are you Korean or Chinese?
Chinese,
sorry. Good man. Thank you. Yes. I haven't got a clue which kind of buyer would buy either of these kind of fish. In England, I know where I was, so I've got to listen, I've got to watch, I've got to find out what they're worth, and who, most of all, is the buyer of this kind of fish.
All of his expertise in London is going to be lost, in Billingsgate is going to be lost here. You know, it's a different world. If you brought me over there, without, no pun intended, it's a fish out of water.
Morning.
He's going to have to learn the buyers.
How are you?
He's going to have to talk to the buyers, and it's going to be very tough.
Morning. 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 I'll get a good morning out of the bastards.
Japanese.
Yeah.
Japanese.
Korean?
Chinese.
By the end of his first day as Frank's salesman, Roger hasn't sold a single fish.
Customers I'm struggling with. I'm not familiar with them. I don't know them. I don't know the lingo they speak. The more I speak to them, the more I shake hands with them, the more that barrier's coming down. It won't be easy, we know that. I'm in a different place. I could be on a different planet. But by God, I'll give it my best shot.
It's like a jigsaw puzzle, and you've got to get it right. Remember, these people play for money. They play a hard game. And when you're playing hardball, you've got to be as good as they are. Because if you're not, you know where you'll end up, on the shit heap. And I've been there before, and I certainly don't want to go there back. So, tomorrow's another day.
Ya terminaron. Pulpo no lo usa. Oye, tengo pescado medio medio bien barato si quieres ponerla ahí.
Roger's not the first new arrival here.
You take only $3.99, $3.88 or what?
In New York, everybody's blown in from a foreign shore.
$3 today. Happy New Year. Yeah. Year of the horse. Wait a minute.
Está como uno 85 eso, loco.
You can tell the story of the city by the faces under this roof.
New York was the melting pot when everybody came into this country in the beginning. They came to New York. And then from New York, then they spread out around the country. But mostly they stayed in New York. You know, you had first your Irish came, then your Italians came, then your Chinese came, and then your Koreans come. So everybody comes in, they start at the bottom, then they work their way up.
You gotta step it up today, boy.
I can't do that. No. These are good fish. I can't do that. I can't do that.
The Italians and Jews still dominate the fish business, but only as traders.
Morning, chaps. Any pollock?
Roger's customers, pollock, they come from far and wide.
You got different guys that come in. My Greek customers have a tendency to be chiselers, okay?
Right.
When they come in, they're going to try and knock you down on the price, stay with the price no matter what it is, right. Okay? Japanese guys, you'll know because they're very quiet and aloof, all right? And
right.
And very respectful. They know exactly what they want. You just let the Japanese guys go about and do it. They'll pick out the perfect perch. Everybody's different. The Chinese guys want to barter, okay? That's right. Just what they do. So if you want to get $1.50 from them, you ask for $1.75, yeah. Because otherwise they're going to bring you down. The Korean guys and the Italians are going to cry. Everything's always too expensive. Don't worry about it. We're staying with our prices. Our prices are what they are. If they don't like them, they can go fuck themselves, all right?
Morning. Morning, sir. How are you? Chinese. Definitely Chinese. Good morning, sir.
Not sure.
Very nice. Good morning, sir. Would you like, sir?
Over the last 10 years, one group of buyers has come to dominate the market.
I got corgi. When I started 43 years ago, the entire industry was Jewish and Italian. As they got older, they sold their stores. Their sons, they would put them into college and they would not have anything to do with the fish business. So as that happened, the Koreans came in. All those mom and pop fish stores that were Jewish and Italian years ago became Korean.
Excuse me, Mom. The cod?
The Koreans now make up 50% of the buyers. And Roger's three sales today are all to Korean fishmongers.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. I'm amazed. I'm actually amazed. I knew Korean shrimp fish, but not to this extent. They dictate the prices. If I'm going to be a success in this market, I've got to get in with the Koreans.
But Roger's not here just to work for Frank. He needs to decide how to trade with his cash too.
All right, and halibut or nice or no?
In Fulton, most businesses buy product from local fish auctions.
What do we got for tomorrow? That's that.
Frank relies on them and has decided this is where Roger's fish knowledge can be put to use.
I think the only way you're going to do this and get better at it, okay, is you got to go to Maine, okay? That's where I get most of my fish.
Now, you know, Roger will act as a scout, grading fish that Frank can then buy.
You're going to spot the fish, you're going to call me and tell me how the spot is,
right.
And we're going to talk about what kind of weight there is there, okay?
Okay,
right. Now, you want to see what you can buy, you're on your own. You can buy your own fish, I don't care what you buy, but if you overpay, it's your problem. And if you're not sure what you're doing, call me earlier so we have time.
I will.
Just don't wait until the last minute, okay?
Okay.
Cool. Okay, good.
Thank you.
Okay.
Has declared a state of emergency for the Mid- Hudson, New York City, and Long Island regions. He says New Yorkers should stay off the roads and remain in their homes until the
As the first winter storm hits the East Coast, Roger heads 300 miles north to the auction in Maine. The bad weather means fewer fish in the market.
A lot of responsibility Frank's gave me. I'm proud and I'm honoured that he's given me this chance. But nevertheless, if I make one faux pas, it could quite easily cost $200 or $300 just winking your eye. So I've got to be on my game here. I've got to know what I'm buying. I've got to get the price right.
But Roger's never one to miss an opportunity for himself.
If I can see a bargain there, if I can snack something up, I mean, I'm a gambler. I want to be involved. I want to see if I can earn a few bucks so we can make a little bit of a profit and come away smiling.
Portland is one of the biggest East Coast auctions. There's top quality fish here from across the North Atlantic.
There's some wonderful pollock here, Frank. Wonderful. Yeah, there's some lovely cod here, Frank. It's stiff alive. It really is quality. There's some nice red perch here, Frank. Not a who'd love it, but it's good. And it's good size, good colour. OK, so I've got a bid for small weights and I've got a bid for quality. OK, Frank, I'll do my very best.
But this is no open auction. Everybody bids anonymously and fish is sold via computer. It's one of the country's most secretive bidding houses.
Today I've come here expecting an auction where you put your hand up, but this is all computerised and I haven't got a fucking clue.
Frank, are you interested in any large cod?
Going with Roger's choices, Frank instructs his buyer, Mickey Varian, to start the bidding. This auction was set up by fishermen, sick of being ripped off by greedy Fulton traders who, for generations, fixed the price of fish. Anonymous bidding prevents traders from ganging together to fix low prices.
Fishermen are always afraid they're getting screwed. And unfortunately, a long time in the old market, especially when there was a lot of fish around, they would gang up on fishermen and they would, you know, and they would just give them horrible prices, you know, and make huge margins. And that's why when auctions became available, people started jumping on auctions because they felt that they would get a truer representation of the value of their fish than they got when they just sent it into somebody open-ended.
With prices now set on the open market, corruption has gone. After 3 hours of buying, Frank has spent over $15,000. It's now Roger's turn to invest his stake.
Me and computers have never mixed. I wouldn't even know how to switch one on. But there's a nice red perch out there, so that's what I'm going to put my finger on the button to. Let's hope I get the right bloody button.
Sit back and wait until it gets all the way down, and then
hit it.
Hey, you're on the redfish. You better get on that phone.
Yeah, Frank, you there?
You ready?
Yeah, the red perch is up now.
All right, get in.
Put your hand on the bar.
Okay.
Don't jump in until somebody... All right, get in quick.
Get in.
Quick.
I've got in.
I'll take it.
74, 77, 78, 79. 79, I'm still in. I'm 79. 79, I'm still in.
Yep, we got it. You got it.
79, we've got it. We've got it. We've got it. We've got it, Frank. We've got it. Yes. I'll let you know the way in a minute. Okay. Yes, we got it.
Well, with a little help, Rogers bagged $250 of red perch, a local favourite with Korean buyers.
I'm as pleased as punch, and I mean that. I thought I was going to go out of here with nothing, and I bought about £300 to £400 of red. Lovely. We'll open up the market on Tuesday with our reds, and I'll make a profit.
Billy, did you find out who's gonna pick up that stuff? Well, let's figure it out, because I don't want it sitting there all night.
Fresh fish arrives at New Fulton every night of the working week. Up to 300 varieties are available, but with the bad weather, local fish are in short supply. Frank is the only other trader with red perch.
That's mine.
Sorry, sir.
Get your hands off my fish.
Saying what wonderful fish you bought, sir.
A nice display. That looks really good. What are you selling, ice?
imported from London? That's really nice. I have 4,000 pounds of perch I brought in today. I think he's got 300. You know, he'll probably find somebody stupid enough to buy from him.
In Frank's eyes, now Roger's got his own fish, his apprenticeship is over.
And at this point, I'm not talking to you for the rest of the day because we are in competition and I am going to kick your ass.
May the best man win.
You got it, baby. Let's go.
Best man win.
Here we go.
Let's
okay.
go. Morning. Lovely, aren't they? Very good quality. I've been here a couple of days. They haven't seen me. They don't who knows who the bastard of Billingsgate is.
How do I feel about Roger selling the fish? I don't care. You want him, he's gonna sell perch. You gotta understand one thing. The gloves are off. I'm here to make money. You guys are here to do what you have to do, but I'm gonna sell my perch first.
Presentation is very, very important.
Mine are better. You want it, I'll charge you 160, okay?
175, sir, thank you.
I'll charge you 120.
Behind Roger's back, Frank immediately drops his price to the Koreans by a third.
Gentlemen,
the way the market operates is what I just did. I undercut him. The idea is to take your competition, stick them with the fish so they're not encouraged to do it again. So if I did that all day, he'll sell nothing.
Morning. Morning.
I don't even think about it.
Beautiful red perch.
I mean, you could be my mother. I'm going to try to outsell you. I'm not going to give you any token. And if you're selling the same product that we're all selling, I'm going to lowball you to death. I'm going to try and drive you out. I'm not going to let you come in and put a hold on my customers. I've got to try and protect myself, my turf.
Wonderful perch. Absolutely wonderful.
Unaware that Frank has done him over, Roger sticks to his prices.
175. Fish is fantastic. The price is bang on. So no trouble. It's just that they don't know me. It may take a couple of hours, but they will, especially if it shortens up. I'm not dear. I'm bang on the market price. I've got no worries.
Okay.
His competition is quietly selling out.
Thank you. Roger. I'm almost out of perch.
Are you?
Then I'll refer him to you.
Thank you, Frank. I appreciate that. Thank you. Good morning. Red birch.
I feel so bad. He's so nice. They don't give a shit. It won't matter. If he offered them for a dollar, he could pee on their legs, they'd buy it. But if he offered for $3.75 and he offered to walk their dog, they're not going to buy it. They don't care. Is it better in London? Are your people nicer?
Morning, sir. Top of the morning to you. I'm Young Hai.
Roger has to drop 50 cents a pound before any Korean will buy from him.
$71.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
You know how much is the bag weigh?
No, the bag don't weigh nothing. $30.
Here you go.
No, it's not a great profit. But I've stood here since 1 o'clock this morning.
51. Thank you very much.
And to say it was dismal is an understatement. It's been fucking terrible.
Only at the end of the day does Roger find out that Frank undercut him.
Frank sold 2,500 pounds. I didn't. They were the same fish. You let me know why he sold 2,500 pounds and I didn't. The bastard Billingsgate has been taught a lesson. But we're men. We know what it's like to get a kick up the ghoulies. But we'll come back. We'll show them what we're made of.
He reminds me a lot about me when I first came here. And I really believe that people are nice and should be treated with respect. And I wasn't ready for the game and how it plays down here. And unfortunately, it after a while, makes you a cynic and makes you hard.
Unlike Roger, Frank had a life before joining the fish trade, working as an actor and teacher before his dad's sudden death brought him into the family firm.
This was not what I wanted to be when I grew up. And when I first came here, I was a please and thank you guy. And I called up the customers and I would try to give them sales. I would deliver to them if they missed it. You wanted me to come in on Sunday, I'd come in. Now I'm bitter and I don't like it. And I don't like the way I am sometimes downstairs. Some days the mood is good. Some days you get so tired of the nonsense and the pettiness and the lies. And after a while, I guess it just, you know, it gets to you.
When Frank began working, the market was in downtown Manhattan, at the heart of the city. Customers and fish were never in short supply.
You would come walking in here, and this is entering the Land of Oz. All of this would be fish. All of this, fish. No cars, no cars. You could fill all of this with fish, and they would sell it every day. You could stay in business no matter how stupid you were. You had to be a complete degenerate to go out of business. I mean, we had guys that were gambling addicts. We had guys that were raging alcoholics, womenizers, and they all managed to stay afloat because there was always more fish.
Throughout the 80s, millions of dollars flowed through the old Fulton Market, but with little regulation, it quickly became a magnet for organized crime and the New York Mafia.
Oh, well, it definitely was racism. It was an Italian, it was a white guy's game, absolutely, Italian and Jews. I watched black guys get beaten up down there. They didn't belong there. You know, not them saying that's right. I mean, I watched four black guys jump out of a car one time and shoot their way out of a mess in the Fulton Fish Market because they were getting hooked in there, because it was a bigoted place.
The Mafia ran the loading and unloading areas, so controlling the movement of all fish in the market.
The unloading, you didn't have a choice. They were unloading your truck. I said, it's my truck, doesn't matter. That's not the way it goes. But everybody was making money, so they didn't care. You know, and the funny thing is, making money is what makes people say, okay, unload my truck, I don't care. No. They're responsible for it, and that's a great service.
The city authority had other ideas. In 1994, Rudy Giuliani became mayor, pledging to eradicate the mob. He used Fulton to set an example. Within 10 years, the old market had been closed and relocated to the Bronx, 8 miles from the bright lights and ready customers of Manhattan.
You're in the middle of the Bronx in Hunts Point, an area where you want to carry a gun or have tinted windows. It's dangerous here. Who in their right mind would want to come to the Bronx to buy fish, as opposed to downtown Manhattan, which was safe and beautiful?
A dodgy postcode and falling global fish stocks have made life difficult for everyone on the shop floor.
I think what you see right now is a market where people are having difficulty making money in seafood. They don't want to lose a penny. And it's bringing out the worst in everyone, I think.
It's 2 days since Roger took a beating on the red perch. Keen to restore his pride, he's back in the market early.
Nobody likes to lose, and I wasn't brought up to lose. They don't remember who comes second. I want the gold medal.
Lovely bit of tuna. Lovely. Lovely shell whiting.
The price-conscious Koreans have proved a dead end, and he's learnt not to compete with other traders head-on.
If the majority of the market have got what I'm selling, why will they come to me? Buyers are very fickle. I've got to find something that the other opponents haven't got.
Hey, how are you?
The one person who can give Roger a leg up is Danny Feig, a high-end buyer supplying Manhattan's top fish restaurants.
Can I have a refresh cod? Can I have 80 pounds of refresh cod for Razzo, please? Steven, any king salmon?
No, sir.
I try to buy the best, only because my customers want it, and it thrills me to know that my stuff is sitting on the table in La Bernardine and La Cirque, and all the fancy people in the world want to eat my fish.
So it's only through experience, though, you've learned where the best fish is done.
Oh, absolutely. Any squid?
Yes, sir.
Can I have 2 squid?
But do you think one of the clues of this market is trying to get something different in?
Oh, absolutely.
Something that nobody else has got.
Absolutely.
There's a niche.
Absolutely. There's always a niche market. Oh, without a doubt.
I've learned one thing from servicing good restaurants. People want something different. Why is soft shell crabs worth
$6 a piece when they first hit the market. I don't think they're worth that kind of money, but people want to be the first ones out there. These are the first of the year. They want to be the most innovative. They want to say, hey, we got it. We're different. We can afford to pay for the better stuff. And that's what the restaurants do. They buy the best.
You know, it's all about making money, and you got to get in there. And
that's what you're going to do.
Yeah, I didn't get up at this time in the morning just to talk to you. No offense.
No offense taken. These guys in the restaurant pay good money. They're not worried about money. What they're always looking for is quality and something entirely different. Now, that's what I've got to do. That's my objective now. Once I've seen this market, how am I going to get into them restaurants? How am I going to get into all the catering people? I'm going to get into them with something that they cannot buy here.
Roger's got a plan. All he needs is a little help from the office back in Billingsgate.
Claire, I want you to get, I want you to get 25 bowl of jelly eels for me now. This is very, very important. Get the very best and get off your arse and get 25 here as fast as you possibly can. Okay, I want them here yesterday, okay? Okay, thank you. Bye now, bye. I've not seen any eels in this market all the time I've been walking around. Whether it'll be a hit, whether they'll go, you're in the lap of the gods. But if you don't throw the ball, you won't hit the coconut. So I'm now throwing the ball.
I took $2 for the racehorse track. Said I'm gonna get 50 back.
Importing new fish isn't unusual in New York. In this multicultural city, there's always a demand for something different.
How much the crab?
But the cost of flying in his jellied eels means Roger has to sell high-end to make a profit. It's a gamble with the stake he's been given.
I am taking a risk. Yes, I'm investing £1,000. It's a lot of money, and it is a lot of money. Don't sneer at it. But if I'm going to make any fortune in this market, I must have something different. And what I'm going to have different is eels.
5 days later, Roger's eels finally hit the Big Apple.
There we are, look at them. Jellied eels.
On a tip-off from Danny, Roger heads straight to Manhattan, home to some of the world's finest restaurants and most discerning customers. He's blagged a meeting with one of the city's top seafood chefs.
This guy is always looking for something new. He wants a new product before anybody else can get their hands on it. Okay, if he doesn't have them, I haven't lost anything. But he might on the off chance. And once I've got my foot in the door, I think we'll sell them, without a shadow of a doubt. Good evening, Ben.
How are you?
Ben Pollinger is the top dog at Oceana, where an average fish dinner sets you back $200.
Fantastic. Look at them for me.
I love eels. Let's see what we can do with them.
Now, these are what you call jellied eels. And they cook them, and they jelly them. They put a bit of water, and then the eels solidify in their own juice. In England, we eat thousands and thousands of them. You have to queue up on a Saturday to get any.
So we just pick out the bone?
Yeah.
Or eat it off the bone?
Some people would go like that. Different, aren't they?
Different is an understatement.
Yeah.
The eel itself has got a little bit of a muddy flavor.
Well, they do eat on the bottom.
But, yeah.
Would you like to put a dash of vinegar on it? Just a dash?
Yeah. Now it tastes...
What do you think?
Now it tastes vinegary and muddy.
These, Ben, are supposed to be the finest eels in the world. They're what you know as silver eels.
Sure.
There's only one place you can get them, that's in Ireland.
A lot of what happens with food and taste and pleasure of what you eat is the mental association you have, the taste memory almost. Like, you know, if you eat jellied eels, you're thinking, okay, you're in a smoky pub drinking a pint, the football games on the telly, and here, now you're in a well-heeled, fine restaurant, it's not quite exactly the same, you know? I think this is gonna be a tough sell.
I mean, jelly deals are jelly deals, that's what they are. That's what they taste of.
Yeah, sure.
That's why probably people eat them, because they taste exactly like
sure.
that.
Sure. You know, I don't mean to disrespect tradition. You know, God save the queen and all of that, but this is, it needs to be more than this, you know?
Okay. Thank you very much for your time.
You're welcome, Roger.
Okay, you know where I am if you want me.
Okay.
Okay.
Take care.
Obviously, they're not the kind of stuff he wants. Well, they eat very earthy, he says, but eels do eat slightly earthy. He might know about to cook a bit of steak and one or two other things, but fucking eels is my game. I am disappointed. Nobody likes to get defeated. But nevertheless, the Beatles, when they went for their first edition, they got turned down. They said, no, you'll never make it. So I'm not going to give up on this one.
A new winter storm shut down schools, shredded airline schedules, and closed government offices from the mid-Atlantic.
To add insult to injury, another storm hits New York that afternoon, and temperatures drop to minus 20. The market is all but iced over.
The wind's blowing, it's picking up the snow. It's absolutely freezing outside. There's nobody here. It looks like the Gobi Desert. Let's hope, keep our fingers crossed.
Snubbed by the high end, Roger now needs anybody to take the eels off his hands.
Jelly deals, Ed. It's getting people interested. Not the easiest thing in the world, but that's what you've got to do. You've got to get them in. Morning, chap. Come and have a bit. Jelly deals. Eels. Very nice. Eels. Take 99 out of 100 people. Once they taste eels, they'll be having eels for the rest of their life. Jelly deals. I grew up in the East End of London. What did we have for Sunday? Eels, cockles, winkles, and a bit of salad. That was Sunday tea. Lovely. Right, this is how you eat them. Pick them out like that.
Are they smoked or are they...
Cooked.
Cooked.
They're very, very popular in England. You don't see, they're all a bit... Oh, I wonder what they are. Oh, and eels actually don't look particularly appetizing. It's only when you eat them. I've got a big custom coming now. I've got to stop talking. Danny!
Now, tell me about these eels. Are these river eels?
These are river eels. But I like them with a bit of pepper and salt on. Nothing tastes like it, does it?
No, definitely not.
I'll give you one now with a bit of vinegar on.
No.
Years ago, they would sell tanker loads of eels to the older people who liked eels. Those people are dead. So are the people in England who like those fucking eels are dead.
When was the last time you sat down and had an eel?
It's white and it's free. Come on.
Lovely.
You could have sent those eels to starving countries. They would have returned them. That was the grossest thing I have ever seen in my life. It was like, you know, oh!
Would you like to try some eels?
I can tell you what Roger did wrong with the eels. Roger likes the eels. He eats the eels. So he decided they were gonna work and he never explored his customer base. And they told him, take the eels and shove them.
After 5 hours, Roger's eaten 25 eels, but not sold a single bowl.
Choke, absolutely choke. If I was given a chance, I'd have done it. But I haven't really had the gods with me. It's been a difficult time.
Just before closing, the last of the Chinese buyers swings by.
No, I can't sell that.
Very good.
I know, but...
Taste.
No, stop. Mm. No, I put it. Yes, I buy that. I put a customer, no charge. I know.
No. Lovely.
No.
Eat one.
I put a...
Oh, lovely.
I know.
This is John. I call him 8535
Roger has no shot at getting the amount of money he's trying to get from him. You know, it's like taking blood from a stone. It will never happen.
My number 8535.
Very hard, man.
Pay the cash.
Pay cash. Take it. I'll give you the bill.
John haggles Roger down to $80 for his 21 bowls of eels, a loss of almost $1,500.
We just sold, no, wrong word. We just gave the fucking eels away.
But what Roger doesn't know is that John Key is one of the most powerful buyers in the market and a vital player in its economy.
Oh yeah, 8535, yes. Mr. Garbage, that's who he is. If you need stuff that has to be moved at a certain price, he'll buy it for you.
He's a great guy. I mean, you gotta love him. But he's fucking ruthless.
We call him a scavenger, but he's a necessary, vital part. And he's built up a niche business for himself. You know what I'm saying? He supplies fish that's basically on its last leg, and the other leg is on a banana peel. Even if you're giving it to him for a quarter, it costs you 30 cents to put it into, like, the dumpster.
At the end of every day, John washes down up to 5 tons of old fish and prepares it for resale. John's business model is not unfamiliar to Roger. But 2 years ago in Billingsgate, Roger pushed it too far and was convicted of selling out-of-date fish.
It's freezing. Don't make no difference to this guy. It's made no difference whatsoever. It hasn't deterred him. Here he is, van and half full of fish, and on he's going.
Take it out, a hinge cut.
Yeah.
Okay, come on.
Which way?
Huh? Turn it up, turn it up.
Turn the other way. The snow's making it harder.
Don't push.
Very heavy.
Another one.
Very slippery. Christ. This is amazing. This is what you call a kitchen. Fuck me.
Morning.
The smell of food, but it's amazing. It's amazing. From behind the doors, you would never know what's going on here today. Go. Yeah. Careful.
How 10 more.
10 more?
Okay, cool. Okay.
There's been a Chinese community in New York since the 1870s. As the population has boomed, 3 Chinatowns have sprung up in Manhattan, Brooklyn, and Queens. John delivers to all of them.
Fuck me, look at them. Live turtles. Look, live frogs, I think. Yeah, they're live frogs. Look, live frogs. Unbelievable.
Oh, yeah, Roger.
Okay. This kid's hasn't stopped. Come on, quickly, come on, come on, quick, do that, quick. Put this back in the van. We haven't started. What about a cup of tea? He's gone again. So this man knows how to work. He reminds me of myself 40 years ago.
Like many Chinese in the 1990s, John was smuggled by boat illegally across the Pacific Ocean.
然后家里的条件不是那么好，然后我家里的父母亲就跟田了，当时是30万人民币的钱之后，然后他就给我们自由了。然后我们领出来的时候，当时就从餐馆的打家开始了，这样反正我们出国都是为了能够工作赚钱寄回中国。He
worked for 3 years to pay off his debts before moving into the fish business.
跟我太太两个人去欧马给旧的鱼市场那边，开始去买一天，做了16个钟头，可以做到800块、1000块的生意。 可能会赚到两三百块的钱，存了大约10年的，来美国10年的时候，我们大约有可以存下10万美元。
I don't know how you got through it. You must
have so much determination. You must have so much character. I don't think I could have done it.
如果是帆船啦，可能分分钟也是，也不知道哪一刻船会翻船的，哪一刻会死的，我们都不知道的，生活也不简单的。我觉得美国是一个充满机会的地方，它是很公平的，只要你肯努力，你肯付出，所有的回报都是很值得的。
John, well done. From rags to riches, this is the American story come true. Because people come to America from all over the world with nothing in their pocket. And this is how you can end up, providing you are prepared to work your bollocks off and keep on going. That's how you end up a rich man.
Roger heads back to the market. He's under pressure. $1,500 down with only a week left. Thanks to the bad weather, all fish are now short, and Fulton's traders are closing ranks.
He needs the product to show he's the new guy on the block, and he needs the customers to come to him. When things tighten up, he's not going to get anything. I'm going to get the lion's share. The other guys who are well established will get their stuff. Bottom line is, our customers are going to come first. We don't want him to build his customers up, you know, so basically we're going to shut him out.
There's nobody going to help you. You know what I'm saying? Like, great whites don't help great whites. You know what I'm saying? If there's a seal, me and you are great whites, I'm going to go after the seal if I'm hungry.
With fish auctions canceled, Roger can't get his own product. He's forced to return to Frank's for work.
Oh, I certainly haven't traveled 5,000 miles to wash down fish. I've done this when I was 15. I don't mind doing it, but that's not what I'm here for. I'm here to get out there and sell some fucking fish and make some money. That's what I'm here for, so I'm a bit pissed off with this, to be honest with you, but what do I do? Tell me what I should do. Leave the man on his own? No. I might need his help. He needs mine at the moment, so that's what I'm doing.
The big freeze grips New York for 4 days. Roger's trading window is shutting fast.
Unfortunately, the weather's closed in on us again. It's made things very difficult. I'm one of them kind of people that like to get amongst it. I like to get my hands wet. I like to get my hands dirty. That's my game. That's Roger Barton's game. Hands-on kind of guy. I can't get hands-on if there's nothing to get my hands on.
For the first time in his career, the Bastard of Billingsgate has nothing to sell.
All my enemies in Billingsgate, they'll be laughing at me and they'll go, ha, see, it doesn't always work out right. Outside, you're all smiles, but inside, your guts are churning up, churning up. You want to get a living. You want to get them on the way. You want to sell them. Get the next lot in. That's what business is all about. I won't do any business standing here when I've got no fucking fish.
It's Darwinism. You know, we either survive or you die off. You know what I'm saying? If you're not a survivor, we'll fill you out.
Roger's saving grace comes in the form of Frank. He gives him the number of a local fisherman known to take risks if the money's right.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Good luck.
Hello.
Hello. It's Dave. Is that Dave?
This is Dave. Who is this?
Dave, my name is Roger Barton. I actually come from England. I'm really desperate to get some fish. I can't stand here scratching me bollocks all day. And one thing, Dave, I'll pay cash.
Yeah, we can work something out, sure. Sure, that's the more fish buyers, the merrier. Competition's a good thing, right?
Dave, you're a diamond. God bless you. And if you get my fish, you're not going to be a diamond, you'll be a star.
All right, very good. I want to make a living.
If the weather drops, he says, and he can possibly see just a window where he can get out maybe for 10 hours and get back in, that's what he's going to do for me. I just keep my fingers crossed and pray to God that he gets out and I get some fish.
Yeah, gonna take you down. Deep down to the front line.
I've now got to do what the Italians have done, what the Jews have done, what the Koreans done. I'm now in that position. I'm the new boy, I'm the man right at the bottom. The glorious thing is, I've got money. Once you bring out the reddies, that's what life's about.
You woke up this morning, you got yourself a gun. Your mama always told you you'd be a chosen one. She said you...
Roger's traveling to Montauk, the closest port to New York. It's his last chance to get fish. But Dave hasn't been in touch since the phone call.
Not many people here at all. In fact, there's nobody here. There's about 4 or 5 inches of snow. I'm not sure whether it's the best weather to go out in. 3/4 of the boats are still here. So if anybody's ventured out, let's hope it's my boat that's gone out. Let's hope it's my boat that's got fish. Because one or two of them are missing. Somebody's gone out, I hope. Let's hope it's our guy.
If Roger's boat arrives, he could be quits in. In a tight market, anybody with product is king.
Weather creates chaos, and there's profit in chaos. The chaos is, it's, you know, these boats aren't going to go out. Too windy. Wave, you know, swells are too high. But let's say you're the only guy in the market that's got fluke or cod. You know, all of a sudden you're golden. You're golden. You know what I'm saying? Because you played your cards right.
Yes, there's a boat coming. Only boat of the day. And here she comes. She's got all the lights on. Fuck me, she's coming. Then it was worth waiting for after all. Hi, guys. You must be Mr. Dave. Good to see you. How much fish we got here today?
Maybe a couple thousand pounds, thereabouts. 1,500.
Roger's decision to pay cash up front is high risk. Nobody in Fulton pays fishermen at the dock. They won't take the risk of prices falling when it gets to market.
Here we got monk.
Lovely.
It's already going hard through the cold air. Wonderful quality. Medium flukes. Second to none. Stiff alive. That's what we call stiff alive. They are the bollocks. Squid. You could actually eat this raw. That's how good it is. Frank, what should I be paying for large flukes?
Before he buys, Roger phones Frank to check prices in the market.
There's been no fish, and there's no fish down there tonight either. I think you've lucked into a seller's market.
Thanks for your advice, Frank. I appreciate it.
I'll tell you what, I want to buy your fish.
Right.
How's that?
That's wonderful.
I could use the fish. The fish is going to be hot tomorrow.
Right.
Very hot. I'm in need of fish, so I'll buy your fish.
Okay. I can't sell anything at the moment, but when I see you in the market, I'll see you there.
Okay, good enough.
Okay, Frank.
Roger's struck gold. He's got some of the only fresh fish on the East Coast, and Frank wants in on the action.
Cheeky Frank, very nice, wants to help me out of trouble. But I'm in no trouble. I've got fish, nobody's got it. And obviously I don't forget. When I had the perch, the red perch, he undercut me, fucking slaughtered me. The old tide's turned now. The ball's in Roger's court. This is where they'll see the Bastard of Billingsgate. This is right up my street. 536
The Bastard of Billingsgate buys the boatload for nearly $5,000.
He is a bit of a tough bastard. He's tough to deal with. I'll tell you, he's good.
$4,470.
Thank you, Roger. Pleasure doing business.
It's been a pleasure. Morning, Joe.
As he's still unpacking, the biggest Japanese buyer descends on Roger's stool.
Okay, how many would you like, sir?
Oh, I'm gonna take three cases and a whole case.
Three cases. Oh, Japanese men, first in the market. They're first in the market at Billingsgate and they're first in the market here. These gentlemen must have quality.
How much is it?
The mount is $2,075.
First customer. Was it worth standing in the cold yesterday for an hour and hours? Yes, it was. Yes, it fucking was.
Over the next hour, he's swarmed by the high-end early bird buyers.
You take the whole box, OK?
How about the ones behind you? Are they sold?
Charlie? No, you can have them.
I'll have those too. So, $7.98.
I'll clean a lot up. Give me the fruit here.
Yeah.
And I'll take 40 pounds. That's 600.
600?
Yeah.
Out of 22 packages, I've got five left, and I've made $2,000. How does that sound? Does that sound good to you? Because it sounds fucking good to me.
He's my customer. What are you doing? I'm going to pop you in a minute. Are you out of your fucking mind? Enough. My customer.
Sorry, sir.
Stop.
By the time Frank arrives, Roger has virtually sold out.
That's it. Roger, do not go near my customers. I'm telling you the last time.
Can't serve his customers. There's a load of bollocks.
He screwed me. Roger didn't play fair. You see, you know, it's tit for tat. You've used my stand, I let him come over and talk to my customers, and then he finally had a hot item and he walked away from me. Not right. It's okay. Revenge is sweet.
I feel terrific. I feel best I've felt since I come to America. At last, I've got the old Americans and I've shown them how to do it. I think Billingsgate will be proud of me today, what we've done. We went out, we bought at the right price, we sold at the right price. You can't do no better than that. That's what a salesman loves to do. You can put your fist in the air and say, yes, I done it. I fucking done it. There you are.
At the end of the day, Roger sells his last three boxes to Frank at a discount. Friendship is restored.
You're very affectionate for an Englishman, let me tell you.
Roger finishes in New Fulton Fish Market with a profit of £5 on the 5,000 he brought with him.
We're going to miss you.
I should miss you, I mean, thank God I got pictures of you with my wife.
I love a guy that loves the fish business.
I love it. You know? Best business in the world.
When I come there, I'm coming looking for a job with you.
Okay, it'll be a pleasure.
Keep telling that tuna, keep writing right, the book. Brother.
You too. You have a safe trip home.
Thank you. God bless you. Whenever you come to London.
When you're nice like that, people adjust. People smile when they see him. That's a gift. A lot of people don't have that.
Would you like to stay in touch? I got my email in there.
No.
That'd be great.
In a market especially like this that's so cynical and so geared towards only one thing, the almighty dollar, you know, and how much you're going to get, you know, and screwing the guy for everything you can get because he's going to screw you the next time. All of a sudden, we didn't have that attitude here, which was nice. Roger makes people have fun. They feel good about themselves when they're with him. He's the Christ of the fish market. He is Yahweh. I can't explain it. He really has a gift. That is really a gift.
It has been tough. They've welcomed me in one hand, but they haven't made it easy for me. I've picked up the gauntlet and done everything I possibly can to show them, you know, what a true blue's like. They're not to be pushed over an Englishman, but okay, we did our very best. Buenos dias, gentlemen.
Next time, Roger heads to Mexico City, the largest food market on the planet.
I would like every Englishman to come out here and see this, bring the wife. She'd love it.
But without a fish in sight, the bastard's got his work cut out.
Just one peso.
15. Oh, 40.
He's got us on the floor, and he's not going to let us up.
And that's at the same time, 9 o'clock next Sunday. But if you can't wait to see more of Roger, he's back at Billingsgate in the Fish Market, available now on BBC iPlayer. Here on BBC Two, catch up with this week's Good News with Russell Howard next.